Well, hey, good evening, church. It's that time to start service, so we're very excited that you're tuning in. Of course, it's a little different than usual, but, you know, we're at church, and as a church, we're going to go ahead and continue with service. So before we start off in prayer, I just want to read a quick little verse. I think we'll be referring to a lot of different verses today, but I just want to read this one real quick before we pray and start worship. And it's in Lamentations chapter 3, verses 22 through 24, and it says, "Because of the Lord's great love, we are not consumed, for his compassions never fail. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. I say to myself, the Lord is my portion. Therefore, I will wait for him." Let that be a verse of encouragement for us during these times. And right now, let's just take a brief moment to pray, and then we'll go ahead and continue with worship. Dear Heavenly Father, we thank you that you are the Lord who's in control of all, and even during times like these, you are our comforter, you're our healer, God. And we ask for those who are in pain or suffering right now, or have loved ones who are in pain or suffering, that you would heal them, that you would provide comfort during these times. And for us who are currently just doing well and just living abundantly, Lord, help us to be a light to those around us, and that we would not live in fear, but we can live in trust towards you and be the church, be the light, no matter where we are, whether we're gathered together with our families at home or with a few friends, we are still the church, God. And we ask you for your blessing during this time of worship and word that will be coming afterwards, that this will be all for your glory, God. And we ask this in your Son, Jesus, God, in your name, amen. We'll continue with worship now.
Good evening, church. Again, thank you for tuning in with us online. It's so great that we have this outlet where we can still meet with one another, even though it may not be face-to-face. And just in these times of hardships and panic, I think it's a great reminder that we have Jesus Christ here with us in control of everything. And as we'll be singing right now, I think it's just a great reminder that through the calm and through this storm that we're going through right now, God will not let go of us. And through every high that we've had and through these low times right now, he never lets go of us. So let's just sing together, "You Never Let Go."
Because even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, your perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back, I know you are near. And I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Oh no, never let go, through the calm and through the storm. Oh no, never let go, every high and every low. Oh no, never let go, never let go of me. And I can see the light that is coming for the heart that holds on. A glorious light beyond all compare. There will be an end to these troubles, but until that day comes, we'll live to know you're here on the earth. And I will fear no evil, for my God is with me. And if my God is with me, whom then shall I fear? Whom then shall I fear? Every high and every low, oh no, never let go, Lord, never let go of me.
Keep on
storm. Oh no, never let go. In every high and every low. Oh no, never let go, Lord. Never let go of me.
Cause I can see a light.
And I can see the light that is coming for the heart that holds on. There will be an end to his troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise you, still I will praise you. Yes, I can see a light that is coming for the heart that holds on. Troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise you, still I will praise you. We're singing, oh no, never let go, through the calming, through the storm, oh no, you never let go, in every high, in every low, oh. Never let go, Lord, you never let go of me. Oh no, you never let go, through the calming, through the storm. Oh no, you never let go, in every high and every low. Oh no, you never let go, Lord, you never let go of me.
Praise God.
A thousand times I failed, still your mercy remains. And should I stumble again, I'm caught in your grace everlasting. Your light will shine when all else fades, never ending. Your glory goes beyond all fame. Everlasting, your light will shine. soul. Lord, I give you control. Consume me from the inside out, Lord. Let justice and praise become my embrace. To love you from the inside out, everlasting. Your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending. Your glory goes beyond all pain. And the cry of my heart is to bring you praise from the inside out, Lord. My soul cries out, everlasting. Your light will shine when all else fades. Never ending. Your glory goes beyond all pain. And the cry. up the broken to the splendor of the King.
God.
Praise God.
Three. Perfect. Thank you guys so much. Let's all thank the worship team for their time and us leading us into worship wherever we may be. We'll go ahead and continue with the next part of our service, and that's going to be the time of announcements. So let's go ahead and just dive into a few things. Things are changing very ever so rapidly, and so it's good to be updated on things that are happening or things that have been postponed. So we'll go ahead and start off with our first announcement, and that's Bible study. We host Bible studies for youth every Friday at 7 p.m., and we will still continue with this tradition, just changing things up a little bit. We will have online Bible studies every Friday at 7 p.m. for the youth, and you can join fairly easily. The information for how to join will be available in our new Slack workspace and also the GroupMe app. So if you are not sure how to join, just make sure you're part of our youth chat, and then you'll be easily able to join us for these virtual meetings on Fridays for Bible study. Our next announcement is the Jesus on Trial Conference. Now, normally this conference was supposed to take place this weekend. However, it has been rescheduled, and we do have the dates for the reschedule. So it's scheduled now to take place on October 9th and October 10th. And if you have any more questions, you can reach out through the website, jesusontrialconf.com. So we hope you'll be able to attend that event as well, even though it's been rescheduled. Just a few other things. We do have a planned Memorial Day camp for the youth, and that's, of course, taking place at the end of May. Currently, the plans are still in the works, so we'll have more information as we get closer to that date. Before we finish with announcements, I just also wanted to bring up that any upcoming church announcements, as they become available, they will just be updated through our website, which is graceav.org. If you go to graceav.org, you'll be able to see everything that's happening in connection with what's going on around us. So now that we're done with announcements, I'll just like to invite Gary to the stage, and we'll go ahead and listen to word. Thank you.
Thank you, David. And thanks to the worship team tonight and to all the servants who have come to make this evening possible. It's just a wonderful thing that we're so blessed as a church that even though the order has gone out that we not gather together as a group, that we can still gather together as God's church through the blessings of technology, and more importantly, through God's Spirit. There's a unity of the church through God's Spirit, and we're able to meet in that way. So just praise God. I hope that all of you are doing well, and that none of you are ill with the coronavirus or any other type of flu or affliction at this time. As we know, everyone's getting a little bit paranoid about people being sick. So again, if you're ill, please stay home, get better, and we look forward to seeing you in person again someday soon. Now, I want to make it very clear to you up front that the reason that we are not gathering together in this public venue as our church is not because of fear. I believe wholeheartedly that our God is able to protect us. He would provide for us, and he keeps us safe from any and all evil. So if that's the case, then why do we not meet together as a church should? Well, first of all, we need to obey all of the scriptures. And if you have your Bibles with you, you can turn to Romans chapter 13. And we'll just read the first three verses in Romans chapter 13. And the first three verses in Romans chapter 13 says, "Everyone must submit to the governing authorities. For there is no authority except from God, and those that exist are instituted by God. So then, the one who resists the authority is opposing God's command, and those who oppose it will bring judgment on themselves. For rulers are not a terror to good conduct, but to bad." Now, this isn't to say that I always agree that what government does is good. It isn't. But in this case, I believe that the authorities are doing their best to ensure that we don't end up with a situation like they did in Italy, which was caused in large part by the government not taking the threat of this virus seriously, and then by people ignoring the warnings to stay at home, and then not listening to the medical professionals. So, you know, as a result, they've been terribly stricken, and it's just tragic. So, yes, we as a church, we are first and foremost Christian. And to this end, our God gives us wisdom to exercise good judgment. And in this case, good judgment means that we listen to and comply with the instructions of the healthcare professionals and our government. Secondly, I believe that given what Paul said in Romans 13, if we were to meet together, not only would we be ignoring the government and the medical authorities, but we would also be putting forth a terrible witness for Jesus. And what I mean by this is those who don't know Jesus would look at our gathering together, in spite of the government's warning, as a flagrant disregard for what they've recommended. And if an outbreak were to occur in this area, whether or not it was caused by our church and church members, we'd probably be blamed for that. And by extension, our God would be blamed for that as well. And that would not be a good witness for our Jesus. An example of this, tragically, was a Christian church in China that continued to meet together despite the government forbidding public gatherings. And because of that, a huge outbreak of coronavirus happened in that town, and the church was shamed, and they had to make apologies to the entire village. So we need to be wiser than this, and we are being wiser than this. And finally, let me say that the pastors and I have spent a lot of time in prayer and thought about this entire situation. We're not operating out of fear or panic, quite the opposite. We've been seeking God's wisdom in all of this. And we believe that our appropriate response as Christians is to remain calm, be wise, and importantly, do our best to remain healthy so that if needed, God forbid, we can go out and serve our community as the need arises. We can step in and help if the hospitals the people are overwhelmed there and the healthcare professionals are too sick to work. We can help to step in to maintain order if our policemen and our firemen get too sick or are too exhausted to work. We can help feeding our neighbors if they get sick and they're unable to care for themselves. I truly believe that the calling of the church at this time is to be the witness to the world, and to witness to the world that we have a safe harbor in the storm. Because we have this safe harbor, we're able to serve and minister to those who have been overwhelmed by illness, fear, or irrationality. If you haven't figured it out, our message tonight is entitled Safe Harbor in the Storm. And why don't we go ahead and lift this evening in prayer, and then we'll go ahead and get started with our teaching. So Lord God, we do thank you and we praise you, Jesus, that you are King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And God, no matter how bleak things may look in our country, around the world, you are in control, and we can trust in you, Lord. We can truly trust in you. And we know that in the end, even if the worst should happen, it's all glorious for us as believers because we get to be with you. So, Lord God, it is our prayer that you will keep our church healthy, so that if we do need to step out into the world, Lord God, we will be able to minister to others and show them the reason we have the hope that we have. We love you, Jesus, and we lift this evening to you. In your name we pray, amen. If you have your Bibles with you, go ahead and open up to Psalm 91, and I'll read verses 1 and 2. The one who lives under the protection of the Most High dwells in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God, in whom I trust. He himself will deliver you from the hunter's nest, from the destructive plague. You know, one of the most amazing things about the benefits of living in 21st century America is that in reality, we have very little to fear on a daily basis. We almost never worry about whether or not we're going to have food to eat or clean water to drink. We never worry about much of anything at all, other than maybe when we're driving down the freeway that we might get the ticket that we rightly deserve. We don't have a reason to fear our law enforcement. We know that they're here to serve us. We also don't wonder if when we're ill or we get hurt, if an ambulance will show up when we call for it, because we know that we have dedicated medical workers that will come to our aid. We have the best medical care in the world, even if it may be expensive. Now, my point in all this is that we rarely encounter something to be genuinely concerned about. And because of this, when a real crisis happens, like what's happening now, many Americans just don't know how to respond. We don't deal with it well. And if you end up watching the 24-hour nonstop news, you might end up becoming panicked over this whole situation. Now, one of the worst things we can do in life is react to a situation out of fear and in panic. And as Christians, we of all people should be able to respond to something like the coronavirus in a calm, rational manner. We should know that no matter what happens, our God is in control. Our God is in control. Psalm 91 was written by David, a man who perhaps understood what it was like to experience daily a threat to his life. No one's really sure how many years David spent running from Saul and his armies, but I think a good estimate is about 10 years. 10 years of looking out from his cave every morning to see if Saul's men had found him. 10 years of not trusting the strangers he met on the streets. 10 years of being a fugitive for all intents and purposes. Yet in all this, somehow David found the peace and the strength to write the words we just read. He found the courage to inspire a group of warriors to be loyal to him, to follow him. Do you think they would have followed him if he was panicked, if he was irrational? I wouldn't have. So how did David remain calm in the storm? Where did he find a safe harbor? In Psalm 91, he wrote, "The one who lives under the protection of the Most High dwells in the shadow of the Almighty. I will say to the Lord, my refuge and my fortress, my God in whom I trust." Now, as I read these verses, there are a few words that David used that really stick out to me. Those words are Almighty, trust, and protection. These three words reveal how David, who was under intense persecution and threat to his life, was able to remain, for the most part — now, this was, after all, a 10-year period — but he was able to remain, for the most part, calm and collected. So what do we see? First, we see that David recognizes that God is almighty. So we need to understand what almighty means. It means to have complete power, to be omnipotent. That means God is in control, not some virus, not Satan, not the hysterical 24-hour news media, not other people, but God is the Almighty. He is in control, period. Yes, we need to realize that whatever may come, God has us in his hands. Do you believe this? Do you believe this? Next, if you do believe God is in control, then the word trust follows both logically and easily. Belief in God's almighty power and omnipotence should help us to trust in him. We can trust God unreservedly. We can trust him without having any doubts or fears that he will betray our trust. God is not human. He's not. He is God. And God is alone, completely trustworthy. Finally, because God is almighty and trustworthy, we can know that he can and will protect us. If you flip a few pages to the left in your Bibles, in Psalm 27, David also wrote, I love what he says here. He says, "The Lord is my light and my salvation. Whom should I fear? The Lord is the stronghold of my life. Of whom should I be afraid?" Wow. I just love how plainly and with complete trust David makes this statement. Saul's men and armies are pursuing him. They're trying to put him to death. But David says, no big deal. God is my stronghold. And if God is my stronghold, then everyone else is powerless against me. As applied to us as Christians, this means that because we are God's adopted sons and daughters, we don't have to fear any virus. We don't have to fear economic collapse. We don't have to fear the future. Now, I want to make clear that just because we're Christians, that doesn't mean we won't get sick or that we won't have economic hardships. We may have them. But it does mean that since God is almighty and trustworthy, he will protect us. How he protects us, well, that's up to God. That's up to him. We don't get to dictate what that looks like. And we might not even like what it looks like. But if we believe and trust in God, then we can know that we are in his hands and that we have nothing to fear. Now, it's precisely because of these three words, almighty, trust, and protection, that we should be, as a church, a bright shining light, a flood of mercy, of love and compassion to our panicked neighbors around us. We should be these wonderful examples because we know we have this safe harbor, Jesus, in the storm. When the need arises, we can and should be willing to go out and help and serve others. If this virus does spiral out of control as it did in Italy, the church, that's you, that's me, we should be willing and with complete confidence, knowing that the Almighty God is protecting us, we should go out and volunteer our time, our services, and our lives to helping others. Now, this might be a time when we get to put into practice what we preach and what we say we believe by living out James 1:27, which is this: pure and undefiled religion before our God and Father is this, to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself unstained by the world. Now, of course, James isn't limiting these works of ours of mercy and compassion to just orphans and widows. They are a representative of all people who are in distress in the world and unable to care for themselves. The point being that even if it is the worldly people who are afraid, even if they are panicked, even if they're only concerned about themselves, this is the time, or would be the time, for the church to step in, for Christians to act Christ-like and to serve others. Because we know that God is in control, if it becomes necessary, we can go into the homes of people that are sick without fear, to cook for them, to clean for them, to care for them. We can go shopping for the elderly who are forced to quarantine themselves in their homes. We can help, if necessary, at places like food banks when the other volunteers, out of fear, have abandoned their jobs. We can fill whatever need God shows us, knowing that we can trust him, knowing that he is our protection. And God forbid, if any of us should get sick, very sick, even to the point of death, then we can have the joy of knowing that we would be living Jesus' command to love one another, having lived out his words, these words: no one has greater love than this, that someone should lay down his life for his friends. That's amazing. Brothers and sisters, we don't know what the coming months and weeks and months rather, might bring. We don't know if this virus will end up infecting just a few thousands, tens of thousands, hundreds of thousands of people. We don't know this. But if it does, we need to be prepared to step in and to help where we can. In fact, we should be actively praying about and looking to see where we may be able to serve. We should be looking ahead. And this needs to start with you. You see, we pastors are just mere humans. We can only keep so much on our plate at one time, just like all of you. But you know what? You're called to be a minister of Christ. And because of that, there's a beauty in this. It's how Jesus designed his church. We're all living stones. We all have differing God-given gifts and abilities, and all of us can find differing needs to go serve. We can become God's ministers, bringing God's love and mercy here on earth. I encourage you, brothers and sisters, not to buy into the fear of the news media, but this is time to look forward with great expectation and hope. Why do I say that? Because you see, so many people go along living their lives, never thinking about whether or not God is real. And they don't think about it until a crisis strikes. There's an old American saying that says, there are no atheists in foxholes. Obviously, wartime is a crisis time. Right now, we're in a bit of a crisis time. And in a crisis time, many people live their lives, especially if they don't know God, in fear and in panic. And this is a wonderful opportunity for us, for God's people, to show God's love, mercy, and compassion to the world, to tell the people who don't know God why you have this wonderful hope that is within you, why you're able to be calm in this storm. I want to close this evening with Jesus' words because, as I say, we look forward with great anticipation and hope for the future. These are great words of promise, truth, and hope. Jesus gave us these words, and the world needs it. The world is without them. But the words that Jesus spoke to his disciples on the eve of his crucifixion 2,000 years ago are words that we truly need to embrace today. We need to soak them in and let them, after we're filled through God the Holy Spirit, let them flow out into the world. Jesus said this on that evening. He said, "Peace I leave with you. My peace I give you. I do not give you as the world gives. Your heart must not be troubled or fearful." Church, this is our opportunity to shine. This is our opportunity to gently witness to those who don't know Christ. Let's all pray. Let's all be on our knees in these days and weeks ahead of us, maybe if this even drags out in the months. God hears our prayers no matter where we are. We don't need to be sitting in a building together for God to hear our prayers, but he hears his people as we get on our knees and we pour our hearts out to our Lord. And I know that if we call on Jesus to open the ears and the hearts of those who don't know him, that he will do that. Jesus says that the hills are ripe for harvest and the workers are few. Church, let us get out and be those workers. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord keep you healthy in this time and invigorate you. May the Lord show you the calling that he has put before you and give you the boldness, strength, and endurance to fulfill that calling and to be lights into this world. Lord Jesus, we thank you for your word. We thank you for your Spirit that you come to live within us and to guide us and to lead us. And Lord, we pray that as a church, we will be open to your calling, that we will hear your voice, that we will go where you call us to go, and that we will boldly love others and serve them as you so wonderfully loved us. We ask for these things in your precious name, Jesus. Amen. Thank you for joining with us this evening. I pray that you will continue to join with us. I pray for the youth to please, please not take this opportunity to just be distracted by worldly things, but to press into your Bibles, to press into prayer, and please join us for our interactive Bible studies. We've been doing some conference calls using this technology, and it's been really good, and I think we can really have a blessed time with this. So church, we love you, we pray for you, and as we adapt to this new reality for however long it takes, we just pray that we will remain together as a church body until we can meet again here in person. May God bless you, and amen.